Hi, I'm Jared Hartke, Rice Extension Agronomist for the University of Arkansas System Division of Agriculture. Today we'd like to visit a little bit about row crop residue burning. It's part in our overall management of our crop residue and how it aids us in just managing our overall crops and crop rotations throughout each season. So behind me today is actually a rice field that has already been burned off. And so you can see some of the ash and everything that's out there present in the field. But you can also see that not all of the residue is gone. So even our best burns, you know, we're not getting all of the residue out of there, out of the field in an individual burn. But it is helping us to reduce the amount of residue that's present in the field, which is going to impact how we further manage that field through the completion of this season and prepare it for next season. So the first point is that crop residue burning actually is a recommended production practice. Like any other management practice, it does carry its own set of pros and cons that we have to deal with and manage. But in the case of burning, yes, it does produce smoke and ash that do lift off from the field, but it also, at the same time, reduces the amount of times that we have to work that soil and till it, and also the amount of diesel and certainly oil that we're burning in all of those trips across the fields. It also has a major impact, again, on preparing our readiness for the next year by reducing all of those trips. One of the other management options beyond burning or that amount of tillage is to actually winter flood those fields to aid in breakdown of the crop residue. That in itself has additional other types of emissions that can be present from those fields. So any of our possible practices are going to have pros and cons, impacts on people, the environment, things, and so we're just trying to overall manage those. In a given year, if we're talking more specifically for rice, we're really only looking at 40%+ of rice acres that do get burned. A smaller percentage of corn acres, corn residue does get burned, and then a very small percentage of soybean or cotton. So it's typically never a large amount of acres, but in a very hot, dry fall like the one we're currently experiencing, we are going to see more acres actually get burned this year because we're going to have drier field conditions and more optimal burn conditions that are going to allow us to complete that task safer and more efficiently than in some other years. The past several years where it's been much wetter during the fall, things like that, we have had to rely on most heavily on the other management practices of tillage or winter flooding to help with those residue issues. And so like everything, it comes in cycles, and this year we will likely see more burning, but we have been fortunate to have really optimal conditions for the past month, really, to accomplish those burns. We're kind of the buzzword that we're after is we want that smoke and residue to get up and get gone, where we have that vertical rising where it gets up and dissipates and doesn't stay close to the ground and move into surrounding communities or nearby homes or anything like that to cause any impact. Keeping in mind, farmers and farm workers and those conducting these types of burns live in and around these communities and don't want to see themselves or their families impacted either. However, everyone that deals with the weather or watches the weather to plan their daily or weekend activities and everything, everyone's very aware that even the best, most accurate forecast can end up being wrong. And so there can be those events where what is forecast as an optimal time to burn and do so safely, effectively, and efficiently, those conditions can change during the middle of the day and lead to unforeseen impacts on others that certainly not intended. So occasionally we do have some of those isolated incidents occur, but we are doing our best to avoid them through we have the voluntary smoke management guidelines that have been developed to provide some written guidance to producers who want to use the burning practice. There's also a hotline for these folks to call and get more information on whether it's a good day and going to be an effective burn day. And then even more recently, there have been some development of really burn predictions coming from some of even our cooperating weather stations giving out that information to give us even the best times of day to focus on. So just because you see, you know, a large column of smoke burning in the distance, it's not necessarily a negative for what's going on. What we want to avoid is any impacts on roadways, communities, other people, and to have one of those good, effective burns. One thing that has become a key in how we burn is obviously trying to get that residue dry. Occasionally where mistakes can be made, particularly with rice, because it's a little unique that after harvest, rice will continue to try to grow. And in some parts of the world, and even in some parts of the U.S., we don't have a long enough season for it in Arkansas, but you can produce a ratoon crop where after harvest it will regrow and produce more grain. That's not really something that goes on here, but instead we get some of that green regrowth, and if we don't time it correctly, or sometimes we just get fooled by how dry the field seems and you have more of that green residue, that's when we'd get a little bit of a less effective burn, and it can be a little smokier and want to linger a little bit longer. But again, in a fall like we're dealing with right now in these conditions, we're really not seeing much of that. We've also learned over time how to deal with rolling or mowing that residue so that it will dry out more, and again, to prepare it for a burn. Historically, we might just be burning when it seemed right as far as conditions, but the field wasn't necessarily ready for an efficient burn. And again, we've continued to transition over time to do the best job of that we can. So the amount of residue that we leave behind when we're growing our crops, particularly rice and corn, again, goes back to the heart of what we're discussing and what we have to do about that residue. In the case of corn, it does break down a little bit more readily in the winter. The problem is there is a lot of it, and we do want to keep and retain a large portion of that residue to incorporate in the soil. But a lot of the loose residue that's out there is a little harder to incorporate and has a tendency through the winter months to actually move around and off the field and cause issues in other areas and dam up ditches and other drainage areas. And so that becomes a concern with trying to burn, again, some of that loose residue. And then we're still going to lightly incorporate what remains, but it removes some of that problem that, again, is not only going to affect those fields, but drainage for other people and areas as it moves downstream. That's somewhat similar and true for rice. So we have a lot of differing rice production systems in the state, so there's not one cookie cutter scenario for managing residue or what's best to burn in all situations for all rice production practices. So you do see a lot of variability out there, and our recommendations do change based on that variability. But like the one I have in a backdrop now that is a zero grade rice field, you don't see any levees running through the middle of it. So this one's going to happen to be a continuous rice field. So it's going to have rice again in it next year. We're in an area that's very flat ground. It's not really fit to grow a lot of our other crops because of how flat it is and how well it holds water, which is great for rice. But it does leave us with that rice residue. So in these particular areas, rice residue is actually allelopathic to rice, meaning it releases toxins as it breaks down that will actually make young rice sick. So if we have a lot of this residue still present next year when we try to grow the rice again, we actually can injure, make sick, or in some cases kill seedling rice by too much of that residue being present. So the options come down to burning or heavy tillage combined with winter flooding, trying to get everything removed so that we can plant for next season. In fields that may contain more levees and are certainly possibly in more of a rotation, again, the situation does differ somewhat, but we are still trying to get rid of some of that residue. In many of those cases, the more levees that are present, the more we're just really trying to burn the loose straw that's there from really immediately post-harvest, and the majority of the residue completely remains in the field. And we're just getting rid of some of that loose stuff that's going to cause most of our complications. Again, can also cause some of the drainage issues, things like that, but also the readiness for planting of the next season and how we get things incorporated. So as we move along, our production practices change, everything evolves. One of the things that's come along in recent years is an increase in row rice or furrow irrigated rice acres. And this has presented a new opportunity for a lot of growers to make our crop rotations even more efficient. So in that situation, we actually get the opportunity to grow rice mostly in a non-flooded environment and instead furrow irrigate, much like we do soybean, corn, and cotton. With that rotation in mind, one big potential bonus that many want to try to utilize is actually, again, going back to where they don't really have to perform any tillage. So we can just rotate from rice to soybean, for example, without actually having to till anything, maybe some light tillage just to recreate our water furrows to carry water down the field. But in order to achieve something like that, again, we still have to manage that rice residue and occasionally the soybean residue on those fields that can pile up at the bottom, again, when we're not tilling at all. So being able to incorporate some burning out there at times is a net benefit. Now, sometimes where conditions are very good and the fall allows for conditions where we don't cause any rutting in some of those fields, then there's some opportunity to actually leave the rice residue almost as a form of cover crop out there over the winter and then just plant soybeans into it. But again, every situation and fall and winter conditions are going to dictate a different suite or combination of our crop residue management practices and how we get prepared for the next cropping season. One of the biggest take homes for us attempting to manage our crop residue is we can't stress enough the importance of how early we get our residue management performed to get ready to plant the next year. One of the single biggest drivers for crop productivity and efficiency each year centers around attempting to plant as early as possible. For the majority of our crops, rice, corn, and soybean, the earlier we can plant, the greater the yield potential. And obviously that the greater our yield, the more efficient our overall production system can be as we move forward in time. So being able to use, when appropriate, all of the tools at our disposal is a net benefit to every year and our overall impact on the environment, other people, our communities, and certainly on overall sustainability and profitability. So in conclusion, crop residue burning is, again, a recommended management practice. It is best for us to incorporate that as part of an overall residue management strategy, but we do need to use it in years where it's appropriate and conditions allow, while allowing for those times when we might potentially impact other people or communities or roadways or other factors, which again, we're trying to avoid. But it is going to provide the best overall benefit and efficient and sustainable crop production. Good luck and be safe during harvest.